thank you very much. What's a wonderful way for us to begin this morning. Thank you to Todd and also to Bob, Desma, Jim. Thank you. It is a blessing that we, during the time when the Monterey Jazz Festival is going on, we always have a service that lifts up jazz a little bit more in our worship life, and it is a blessing. So as we get started this morning, let me extend a welcome to all of you who are here today, members and visitors alike. It is a pleasure to be able to gather with you again this Sunday and worship together. You'll find in your bulletin that we have printed the whole service as usual. It should be straightforward and easy to follow. Let me remind you, as I usually do, that if you have a cell phone with you, you might want to put that on silent, and that you also have in your bulletin a number of inserts today, but the green one is a response sheet, and I'll just invite you to fill that out and place it in the offering plate a little bit later in the service. So as we get started today, besides hearing good music today, jazz today, besides hearing that, we also hear in both of our lessons, really, a call from God to think about what motivates us. And so before we begin with our confession and forgiveness today, we think about some of those motivations maybe that drive us to want to have more than others in particular. And maybe the deeper drive of the anxiety that is underneath that, that we all of us, have to deal with. So we hear that call as we begin our service today by confessing our sins and remembering God's promise of release, of forgiveness to us once again. I invite you now to stand or kneel as you're able and let us confess our sins. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the one who fashions us, the one who heals us, the one who reforms us again and again.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin, calling for God's transforming power. Let us confess our sin, source of all life. We confess that we have not allowed your grace to set us free. We fear that we are not good enough. We hear your word of love freely given to us, yet we expect others to earn it. We turn the church inward rather than moving it outward. Forgive us, stir us, reform us to be a church powered by love, willing to speak for what is right, act for what is just, and seek the healing of your whole creation. Amen. God hears our cry and sends the Spirit to change us and to empower our lives in the world. Our sins are forgiven. God's love is unconditional, and we are raised up as God's people, who will always be made new in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
I want you to see if you can guess, based on the pictures that I brought, what the one word theme of today is. What's in those pictures? There's nature, yeah, but it's a different one I had in mind. Mountain, that's right. That's exactly right. These are some pretty big mountains, I think. I think this one might actually be the Himalayas. I think that one is probably the Rockies, which is in the United States. I'm not sure where that one is. It could be really close by, but I think there may be some ski lifts on there. So, do you have to go very far to go to a mountain? No. We have mountains all over the place, don't we? Here in California, we have lots of mountains. In fact, right here in this church, we're kind of partway up a mountain, aren't we? It's kind of up on a hill, right? You ever think about that? Yeah, kind of up on a mountain. Mountains all over the place. Do you like hiking in mountains? Do you like that? Have you ever done that? Maybe? Well, what can be really nice about going hiking in the mountains is that you can see things that you don't necessarily see in your backyard. You can see all kinds of, like this one has lots of pretty wildflowers in it. And this one has some great big trees in it. You can see some great big trees in some mountains. In other places, it could be like this where it's really rocky and rugged. And just the mountains themselves and the rocks can be really interesting and beautiful. You can see all these things. And people for a long, long time have always thought of mountains as being kind of a sacred place, like a holy place. And so back in the time when the Old Testament was written long, long ago, you know where the temple was? It was on the mountain. Yeah. And I've been there. I would say it's not a very big mountain, actually. It's probably not much bigger than this one that we're on here. But still, that was the idea. It was on a mountain. And people thought mountains were a good place to go and sometimes be alone and pray. It was a place where, in some ways, people felt they were closer to God. Maybe we sometimes still get that when we go out in nature. We can feel a little bit more alone, and maybe that's a good way to get in the frame of mind where we can talk with God. Today we give thanks for all of nature, for all this beautiful planet that God gives us, and we give thanks for those places that God gives us where we can go together and pray, even this church right here. So, let's pray together. Gracious and loving God, we thank you for beautiful mountains and all of creation that you have given us to care for and to be part of. We thank you that you draw us closer to you as we see these beautiful places, and help us to open our hearts that we may hear you speak to us your love today and always. Through Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. Thanks for coming.
It's a reading from James. Who is wise and understanding among you? Show by your good life that your works are done with gentleness, born of wisdom. But if you have bitter envy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not be boastful and false to the truth. Such wisdom does not come down from above, but is earthly, unspiritual, devilish. For where there is envy and selfish ambition, there will also be disorder and wickedness of every kind. But the wisdom from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, willing to yield, full of mercy and good fruits, without a trace of partiality or hypocrisy. And a harvest of righteousness is sown in peace for those who make peace. Those conflicts and disputes among you, where do they come from? Do they not come from your cravings that are war within you? You want something and do not have it, so you commit murder. And you covet something and cannot obtain it, so you engage in disputes and conflicts. You do not have because you do not ask. You ask and do not receive because you ask wrongly, in order to spend what you get on your pleasures. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Gospel according to Mark.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus and the disciples went on and passed through Galilee. He did not want anyone to know it, for he was teaching his disciples, saying to them, "The Son of Man is to be betrayed into human hands, and they will kill him, and 3 days after being killed, he will rise again." But they did not understand what he was saying, and were afraid to ask him. Then they came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you arguing about on the way?" But they were silent, for on the way they had argued with one another who was the greatest. He sat down, called the 12, and said to them, "Whoever wants to be first must be last of all, and servant of all." Then he took a little child and put it among them, and taking it in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. Thank you. After that, I know that you're not worried. You're not tense, right? That's good. Because I'm going to talk a little bit about worry, about anxiety. And I sometimes worry, for starters, that the way we are raising our children in this society is simply all wrong. I worry. I know why we do what we do. We are told that our children need to go to college, and that college is increasingly difficult to get into, and that it is also, at the same time, getting increasingly more expensive. So, we raise our kids to be competitive, to be really competitive. We tell them to work harder in their academics. Maybe we even ride them about that on a daily basis. And we tell them that they have to be the very best at their elementary school, at their junior high or high school. We tell them to take on all kinds of extracurricular activities, sports, music, dance, scouting, volunteer work, whatever, the list could go on. And it can be truly overwhelming. Has it gotten worse? Has it gotten worse since I was a child, since you were a child? Yeah. I know it has. But I guess I have to start with confessing that I was one of those kids. I did this myself. My sisters did too, my two older sisters. The difference is that we were more of the exception in our time in school, in high school. Now it's become the norm. It really has. And so you just have that friction all the time. Competition. Go, do more. And what's the result? What is the result? I don't think we even know yet. But has this whole generation, and the generation coming, have we all become so focused on achievement that it's just distorting our society in ways that we can't hardly imagine? That is the way it is, right? That we have distorted our society by our own anxieties about the future, about getting ahead and success and having security. Our own anxieties about finances and all that other kinds of success. And we are passing this on to our kids. That's what's going on, isn't it? We want our children to be the greatest. But have we given them a burden that is just too heavy to bear? What do we want to aim for with our kids, with our children? We want to help our children. Yeah, we want to help our children learn. We want to share with our children the things that we love to do and make, like sports, like travel, like music, theater, art, cooking, home repair, nature. Again, the list is long. The things that we all love, whatever it is that you love, we want to share those things with your children. And then we also want to encourage them to explore their interests and discover those places in this wide world where they can use their own gifts. Most of all, we want to show our children that the greatest joy in our work and in all of life is sharing what we have and who we are with others. The very heart of the good life is loving and serving, right? And we have to understand that in the broadest sense. Because when we say love and service in the church, we very often are thinking about just these charitable things that we do. There are various particular ways that we serve, like at the food pantry or somewhere else. But no, broadly, we're talking about our whole way of living. How and why we do our jobs. You know, how and why we work and play at home. how and why we travel, how and why we participate in our local communities in various ways or engage politically. How and why? The how and why has to do with love and service. The most important thing we teach our children is truly how and why we live. Because they are, of course, watching that more than anything else. What concerns me then? What concerns me is that when we tell them that competition is all that there is, they begin to take a different course in life, and one that, by definition, is less love-filled, less joy-filled. How did we get here? How did we get here as a society? How is it that our really wealthy society has created so much anxiety, not just for poor people, but for middle-class people? How is it? You know, I know I can't really tackle that question today. I know that some of this comes from this this period of dramatic, dynamic change that we are seeing in our time, changes that have been underway for quite a while, through most all of our lives. But these changes are accelerating faster and faster. And so let me just say briefly aside here, for more study on these things, come to our adult class today, and we will get into this a little bit. I do know that this anxiety, though, this anxiety goes beyond our worry for our children, right? This anxiety is throughout our culture. Consider, for another example, where we sit here in this building, in this church. We worry about our future, about the future of this congregation, and about the future of the whole church. And not just the ELCA, but the whole church in the United States, the whole church in the Western world. We worry. And we look back. We look back to the 50s, maybe before, and we look backward with some longing. Might we be tempted, as we sit here today, to look back and say, we want to have our church be great again? We want our church to be the greatest. More than a little tempted. Here's the thing I want to point out. It's just simple English. You know, great is a comparative term, right? It's a comparative term. And so by definition, if one church is going to be great, it has to be better. It has to be better than other churches. It has to be better than at least one other. Probably many, right? In our mind, that's how we think. Again, I want us to just notice that our desire comes largely out of this competition, and that competition comes out of that anxiety that we are swimming through, that uncertainty that we are just is part of our life. And it's a really common human response for us to say that we have to be the best, to feel like we have to compete, because part of us is worried. Let me suggest that winning, that being the greatest, that defeating others is not what Jesus is calling us to. But we have some other examples today, right? Examples we hold up today, like jazz, for example. Because jazz and music in general is a great example. Music is not something that we just force upon our children so that they can improve their college applications, right? Music is an ancient thing, a very human thing, an absolutely vital piece of humanity, especially when we think about humans living together and living in community. It is central to our worship life, especially as the Lutherans, central to our worship life through virtually every religion. And it goes far beyond that. Here's the thing about music. It is always a cooperative activity. It is always a cooperative activity. It connects people by that invisible fabric of sound waves in much the same way that the Holy Spirit abides in us and connects us to one another. And jazz provides a particularly good example of this in that, you know, you think about jazz where you have a number of players who will pass along a musical line, idea, thought, emotion. They will take it, play it, pass it on to another player, and that player will take it and shape it, and then pass it on to another player and to another. The emotion expands and builds among the players. And all the while, the audience is enveloped in that sound and shares in that experience. You know, most performers will tell you that the audience itself truly changes the performance. See, let me tell you a couple simple ways this happens. You know, when the hearers, when the audience is stressed out or tired, or performers know this, whether they're music performers or actors or whatever, they know that the performance suffers because of it. And, you know, they know when the audience is enthusiastic and everything has a lightness and life in it. This is actually true in all of life if we pay attention. All of life. We are always connected to one another and to all of creation. And our call is to be part of that and to love and serve in the midst of that. And so for this we pray, God, help us. The other example we have today, of course, is Jesus himself. Jesus himself, for he teaches his disciples as they walk together and as we walk with them. We know what this means. They are on their way to Jerusalem. We know exactly what that means. We know what happened there. Jesus went with his disciples to Jerusalem in order to transform them and us and the whole world. Jesus went to Jerusalem not to lift himself up, but to humble himself and to serve. He became the least, the very least, for the sake of God's reign entering into our world and our lives now. You know, his disciples weren't so good at this. They didn't get it. And I'll tell you, read Gospel of Mark, they didn't understand it again and again and again. They continued to not understand, and then they would betray him and abandon him. Jesus, however, was faithful to them. I think we recognize ourselves and the disciples. We know that we're far from perfect, that we continually fail, that we continually let those anxieties that are just part of our time lead us to do things that hurt rather than heal. Still, Jesus died for love of us and all of creation, so that we, by the grace of our baptism, we may have confidence that God never leaves us behind. God actually keeps coming for us, lifting us up. And so in that spirit, we pray, God have mercy on us. I think we never fully leave behind those anxieties that we had when we were a child, no matter what our age. But like children, Jesus still welcomes us. As people growing in faith and love, we hear the call today to follow in love and service, to welcome the least, to comfort the fears of children, to relieve the anxieties of the poor. And as we walk with Jesus, we pray today, thanks be to God.
Thank you.
by God in Christ to live and love and serve, we pray for the church, those in need, and all of God's beloved creation. Gracious God, you gather congregations together by the power of your word. Bless leaders with the gifts of wisdom and discernment as they seek to make your church the community for which you long. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Creative God, blue whales and honeybees sing the goodness of the earth. Glaciers and deserts declare your greatness. Make us good stewards of our home for the generations to come. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Sovereign God, you raise up governments to protect the widow and orphan. Bless citizens with wisdom and discernment as they choose leaders. Inspire leaders to always seek the common good. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Loving God, you desire health and wholeness. Reconcile the conflicts and disputes among us. Teach us to heal the trauma of racism and poverty. Break our hearts open to all those who suffer and mourn, especially those we now name aloud or in our hearts. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Welcoming God, you place children among us. Teach us to honor the children in our midst and to pay attention to what they can teach us about who you are. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
You surround us with a cloud of witnesses who announce the good news of abundant life to a sad and needy world. Make us a pilgrim people, always telling the story of your loving kindness. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Into your wide embrace, gracious God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your boundless mercy through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer. Amen.
Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us share that peace. Peace be with you.
There you go. Yeah.
Well, as we are getting settled here again, let me just invite your attention for a moment to some announcements we have. And we do have things on the very back page of the bulletin for starters. Very first item on there is the announcement about the adult class. It happens after worship. We have actually time for refreshments over here in the lounge, and then those of you who would like to come to the class will be at the other opposite end of the education building for that class. And it is a study of what shape does the church take, does Christianity take in the future, and what does that mean for our church as we know it? And as well, that is always part of what's happening in our wider society, and what does that look like? Really got an interesting way of thinking about the world and where we fall in it. And it's sometimes very helpful to be able to see these things as they are, because we tend to want to put it out of our minds and not worry. But when we are aware of these things, it can actually help us to deal with these changes more calmly. So I invite you to come to that class today. Also, please note that this week we have epistle articles are due on Tuesday. Our diagonal circle will be gathering on Tuesday afternoon, and Thursday is our usual Christ in Our Home group meeting at noon. Now, upcoming, there's some important things. Next Sunday, we will be having our St. Timothy and Friends concert at 3 in the afternoon, right here in this place. A number of people performing. Would you like to add anything about that at this point?
Sure. As you can see, we have a lot of talented performers with us. Todd, you saw him on piano. He was playing an original composition, by the way, this morning, his jazz waltz. Yes. Todd will be singing. We have Bob on trumpet, Bob singing, everybody singing. And we have Rich Houston. And I begged him. I didn't have to beg, actually, very hard for him to do his Tevye role. If you haven't heard him sing Tevye, you have to come and hear one of his songs from Fiddler on the Roof next week.
Yes. All right. Thank you very much. And then the following Sunday, we have Blessing of the Animals scheduled, and weather permitting, we will actually have our worship in the community garden area. Now, by weather permitting, I mean if it's not raining, of course, but also as long as it's not too cold. And what I would tell you about the Blessing of the Animals is that you're welcome to bring your, reasonably well-behaved dog or even cat, although I would never inflict that on my cat, but or other pet that you can bring with you. But also that if you have a pet that you know you can't bring, you are welcome, if you'd like, to bring a picture with you of your pet, and we will offer our blessing for them. A question.
Oh, a question, yes. I was just wondering, in setting the bar for reasonably well-behaved, where does Buster go? Is he reasonably well-behaved spectrum?
He's generally very well-behaved, but he has his moments.
As you do.
Yes, as we do. Yeah. Okay, so also a reminder that September is our faith-giving month, and we have one last Sunday in September. Okay, let me pause at that point and just mention, in terms of inserts, there is one about the Blessing of the Animals, and there's also one about Hurricane Florence, that ways that you can give towards relief regarding Hurricane Florence. Are there any other announcements we should hear today?
We have tickets available for the concert next Sunday, and rather than waiting a long line for half, for offering them now. So we have, Debbie will be back there after the service to sell tickets and what you want.
Thank you. Okay. Okay. All right, well, I know that there's something else I'm forgetting. I'm sorry that I'm forgetting. Oh, no, now I remember another important announcement, and that is that a number of you have been contacted regarding some getting together to do some planning around some visioning for 2019, groups for starting a walking group and a group that would be serving meals, a group that is a book club and slash maybe games. So you should have received that by email, but I will tell you that, let me see if I can remember this right. Today at 1 o'clock, the group will be gathering to discuss what does a walking group look like? And I know that can take lots of different forms, and so we'll gather at 1 today to begin to give some shape to that. We'll do the same thing for the other groups on Wednesday night. In my email I said 5:30 and 6:30. And there's a lot of overlap in terms of people, so Wednesday night. If you're interested in one of those focuses and you're not able to be there for the planning meeting, please see me, because I would like to get some of those additional ideas by way of either today, or if not this today, then maybe on Wednesday or in some other way. So please do talk with me about that. Okay. So now let us come to the table, and we come today, of course, dealing with a number of anxieties in our world that we find ourselves part of and immersed in. And we come remembering this promise that is given to us, that Christ comes to us in this bread and wine, and we are given that promise. God is indeed with us always, and we are filled with that, so we may go forth sharing that love and peace, serving one another, connected to one another always, and bringing light and life to this creation. So come and receive, and go forth and serve. All are welcome at this table that Christ puts before us. We will be communing today in the aisle. Commune by intinction, which just means that you'll receive a piece of bread. You may hold on to that and dip it either into the first cup with red wine or the second one with white grape juice, as you prefer. After receiving, you may return to your places by way of the side aisles. We also do have a gluten-free option. If you need that, please let me know. So let us now prepare the table as we bring forth our offerings for today.
This is the same.
Let us pray. God of life, you give us these gifts of the earth, these resources of our life and our labor. Take them, offered in great thanksgiving, and use them to set a table that will heal the whole creation. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. This far along the way. In times of bitterness, you did not abandon us, but guided us into the path of love and light. In every age, you sent prophets to make known your loving will for all humanity. The cry of the poor has become your own cry. Our hunger and thirst for justice is your own desire. In the fullness of time, you sent your chosen servant to preach good news to the afflicted, to break bread with the outcast and despised, and to ransom those in bondage to prejudice and sin. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we drink of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Remembering, therefore, his death and resurrection, we await the day when Jesus shall return to free all the earth from the bonds of slavery and death. Come, Lord Jesus. And let the church say amen.
Amen.
Send your Holy Spirit, our advocate, to fill the hearts of all who share this bread and cup with courage and wisdom to pursue love and justice in all the world. Come, Spirit of freedom. And let the church say amen.
Amen.
Join our prayers and praise with your prophets and martyrs of every age, that rejoicing in the hope of the resurrection, we might live in the freedom and hope of your Son. Through him, with him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, Speak to us, O Lord, in the breaking of the bread, and make us one with you.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Holy and compassionate God, in bread and wine you give us gifts that form us to be humble and courageous. May your words come to life in our serving and in our witness, that we might speak a living voice of healing and justice to all the world, through Jesus Christ, our Rock and our Redeemer. Amen.
God, creator of all things, speaking reformation into being. Jesus Christ, Savior of the world, raising the dead. Holy Spirit, living voice, calling and enlightening the church. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen.
Sends us forth to serve. Go make a difference.
Thanks be to God.